about who looking down on me, who proud of me. That reassurance would be nice to know I'm killing things. Been going through the motions, cause lately I ain't been feeling things. Been to myself more, the music always healing things. I watch close friends react to me in situations. Niggas act like they ain't got the patience. Whack.
This is As of Late Podcast. It's your boy Titus, and we got Lute with us. What's going on, my brother?
I can't call it, my boy.
Good to see you, man. Good to see you.
I cannot call it.
Well, I appreciate you coming, man.
Yeah, back for on. Sure.
I seen you over at Petra's for that Mercury show, man, and we were able to shoot the shit a little briefly. Mm-hmm. What did you think about that show? Are you familiar with Boyd?
Yeah. I thought the show was fire, and plus, this nigga Kevin, you know what I'm saying?
Monster, like, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Such a dedicated, talented dude.
Very man. Talented individual.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. He's next up, man. He just got to... Just got to get the right management, really. I tell him, like, once you get the right management, bro, the sky's the limit.
Yeah, I feel that. Or just the team behind you in general.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's important. Mm-hmm. But, you know, you do what you can.
Mm-hmm. Make it work.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. I talked to him briefly after he performed, and he was telling me about how someone like that is so shell-shocked, in a sense, of preparing for himself to where he's very antisocial. Mm-hmm. And to have someone like that that can pretty much sing and blurt out the levels that he's doing, hitting the octaves that he's hitting, it always surprises me that artists like that will be the most caved in when it yeah. comes to not even really, you know, talking to people and being a little bit dealing with anxiety struggles. Mm-hmm. And then I thought about you, where me and Todd Chris were talking, and I was like, man, like, I was like, bro, it's something about Lute, man, that reminds me, like, this nigga. I think this nigga might be my cousin or something, bro. Because you give me similar, where it's just like when something clicks, when it's time to do something, you're built for it, tough for it. But outside of it, it's like you give me the very chill, like, you know, very anti. You know, I gotta, you know, I ain't really the gonna bother you unless I need
to be.
You know,
it's crazy. Like, it always come off like I'm antisocial. Mm. I'm very social. But
with the right
I just
people.
Feel like, yeah, with the right people, but I just feel like sometimes my body language give off that I'm antisocial only because that'd be my anxiety wanting to play, like me being in my phone or me just seeming distant. But it's just like my social anxiety or my social awkwardness.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. How do you get through that being an artist? Because I find it also fascinating when you have someone like you, you're a Forever FC alum, pretty much, where it's like, you, that's where I first seen you, with shout out to, like, Kelso.
Yeah, shout out to Forever FC.
Phenomenal, you know, at that time, making beats. I ain't seen Kelso in, I don't know, it's been a minute. Like, I've always seen him from afar. I actually really don't personally know him. Mm-hmm. I've seen Rye, and
that's yeah, I met Jimmy, and me and Jimmy met, like, seventh grade.
Really?
Yeah. I've been my nigga since middle school.
I met him through the internet. We were dating the same chick one time.
Word? Yeah, that's wild. But it don't sound off though.
Yeah, yeah. We were dating the same chick, and I was like, I was simping hard. I was like, yo, man, just tell me, man, is she still fucking you, bro? Like, what's
yo,
going on?
Yo, that's
right?
Nuts, bro. That's wild.
Yo, that's my first introduction to Jimmy Kelso. And then it was to the level where it was just like, yo, man. That's even the energy, like, with him and you, it's like, I can't fucking be mad at this dude, man. This dude is mad fucking laid back, man. He's mad chill. And, you know, what turned out, well, the chick was doing what she did. She belonged to the streets at that time. But it wasn't with Kelso. It wasn't with Kelso. Mm-hmm. But I say that to say, you come from where, being in the city, you establish yourself with that group, and then somebody that struggled or still kind of struggles, you deal with anxieties and stuff when it comes to performing, probably you got to get yourself mentally there.
Oh, hell yeah. I mean, shit, that shit happened to me earlier today on this podcast. Well, the podcast I had earlier.
The Insta Live.
Yeah, like, I don't know what it is about my anxiety when it comes to just being out in public or just being out in front of people. But, yeah, that shit be hitting me like, like a ton of bricks, bro. Like, I don't know. It just comes out of nowhere.
Yeah. It comes. Because,
you know, like, we've been in settings where, like, we be out and, you know, we be chopping it up, laughing and having a good time and shit. But, like, when it comes to, like, just being on the spot or the camera in your face and just being in, like, the public eye, I don't know what it is. That shit just gives me anxiety. Like, super, super bad anxiety.
Yeah. That's crazy. Mm-hmm. I can't even imagine that level. Where it's like I was telling you, I don't know if you remember this, we were talking at that Mercury show. I was like, man, like, if it was on Fuzzy's podcast, I wouldn't be out here.
Like, we were just talking about how, like, the things that we into is based on, like, us being able to cope with, like, our anxiety or the things that we deal with or go through on a day-to-day basis. Like, for me, when I ain't really had nobody to really talk to like that, I was writing verses, and you was like, you know, your outlet was doing these podcasts, and I don't know, you find that thing, that niche that helps you cope, and you, it's almost like that, what's the nigga name, Linus, is that the nigga that had the blanket on
I'm trying to
Charlie tell Brown, it was Linus, yeah, Linus. You know, it's like that security blanket, I don't know.
Yeah,
I don't know if that makes sense.
Yeah. It is. It is my blanket to a degree. It definitely started off as that, and still is. And so, because for me, this was really a way to, and just like with putting lyrics together, it was therapeutic. I did this really because it came at a time where a friend of mine had passed, and I was on my Rick James shit at that time because it was just like, I don't care about nothing. This nigga just died. This is the nicest nigga that I known around you niggas. You niggas is fake. And so it was just like, it really was a coping dealing with that and trying to tell people the ups and downs of dealing with depression while at the same time, because at that time I was writing lyrically, but I'm switched it to where I'm doing books now. But at that time I was dealing with the struggles of letting people too much into my, living my art pretty much, letting people too much into my world to where it was just like, the depression that I was writing in was settling in my spirit. And I, you know, like, I had a problem with that because I was like, man, I was living it too much. I was indwelt with it too much. Do you find yourself having those moments where it's like lyrics from your past when you perform them? It's just like, or even with new lyrics, it's like kind of like therapy. You got to leave that in the booth because sometimes you're
second like, even with certain shit, like, bro, everything that I've rapped in my music came true. Or everything that I've rapped in my music happened. So I feel like with music, it's like manifestations. If it's not really, like, you know what I'm saying? If you're not talking about like present day or whatever, like sometimes that shit just manifests into other shit. And it's like everything I rapped about, I've been through. You know what I'm saying? So, I think.
Words are powerful, man. I tell people all the time, you know, it's an old scripture, you know, it says life and death is in the power of the tongue. And so I think that's one thing where I started to realize that in the way that I speak, in the way do I talk to people. You know, I don't hold grudges anymore. I bless people. I try not to curse people because even with the thought pattern or some things, you know, you put that stuff, like you said, everything you've been rapping about, you, whether it was you back in the day in like 2012, like, dreaming about the deal, or are you just talking about your everyday struggles being on the West Side? Like, that's stuff that you've been through, or you manifested it with your words. And so words are so powerful, man. And I hope, especially when it comes to like the younger artists, that they realize that, because we're seeing it come into fruition, like people talking about death, and then within a couple of years they're actually out of here.
That's why I don't really talk about that shit because it's like, I feel like, again, like the music you make is the shit that you manifest. And so, you know, talking about, I don't know, it's just certain songs when you see people that have passed or got killed, and you go back and listen to certain lyrics, it's like, dang, he predicted that.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, nah, I don't want to be in that position or predicament. So I don't even talk about hell. I don't even be having guns in my videos.
Like, and it's like, where do you find the line with that though? I mean, if I'm someone like themselves, because you're talking about somebody like, I had a dude on here last week, this dude named Clint from the Four, young dude, 20. About that life, about that action. It's not like he's saying facade stuff. He's,
no, for sure.
In another way, he's pretty giving. It's poetic. Right. He's giving people really what's going on. And so it's like, it's crazy how you still got to find that line to where it let people in, but then don't put it too much on you where it's almost like Pac, to the degree where I feel like Pac spoke a lot of that stuff onto him. Right. The stuff that he was talking
but
about.
Shit, like my mama say, you know, you live by the sword, you die by the sword. So
that's a fact.
Yeah. You know,
that is a fact. When you made the transition into going from the group with somebody like yourself that struggled with the anxiety, how difficult was that transition of doing a solo, like a solo set when you're around your fellas, and then you make that transition Cause I was watching Eric Benet. It was definitely different.
Cause yeah, you used to having backup
and to your left and to your right.
You used to having that backup and that reassurance, and it was something I definitely had to get adjusted to, where I had to redefine what music meant to me. So that I could regain and rebuild that confidence again, if that makes any kind of sense.
Yeah, it makes perfect sense.
It was definitely a difficult transition because, like I said, you used to having that support and that, for me, I'm out with my brothers now I'm on the stage and it's just, I don't know. It was definitely a different kind of transition. I still get anxiety on stage, though, to answer your question. Like, that, it really never changed.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's just now it's more heightened because I don't have, I don't have that comfort of support, you know what I mean, on stage. But, I still had anxiety then performing as Forever FC. I had hella anxiety, but I got even more anxiety now, over the years,
That's crazy. That's crazy that it probably, like how you said, in levels, it heightens up. And it reminded me, like I said, I brought that up because I've been watching I watch podcasts all the time, and Eric Benet was on one. I don't know if you remember the dude that used to be with Halle Berry back in the day.
Yeah.
And dope R&B singer from back. Well, he's still making present stuff, but he was talking about how he didn't get into really identifying himself as Eric Benet until he went solo, because he came from a family full of singers, and originally he got his deal with his sister. And how, because everybody was just like, he's mad earthy now. And and nigga be taking his shoes off on stage and shit. And he was like, nigga, I did that because of my anxiety. It wasn't even trying to be on some earth realm shit. I did that because that made me the most comfortable. I was scared as shit because I was so used to looking to my right and seeing my sister. And so it made me think of you too. It was I wonder in the beginning stages when he was doing those solo sets, you're so used to being with your group. And then it's damn, this is really my first solo show. And it's how do you deal with that? And you made a perfect point.
It was definitely a transition, but, I still deal with anxiety. So I'm still trying to figure out ways to better cope with that. You can have a routine down, you can, but each show is different. When it comes to how the anxiety hits. You know what I mean? Each show is different.
Bigger the audience, more anxiety, or
it ain't even the audience no more. You get used to certain things after a while. After you do it so many times, you get used to it. I can perform in front of however many people. That's not what's really giving me an anxiety. Because to be real with you, you can't really see everybody when you're on stage. So the crowd doesn't give me anxiety. What gives me anxiety is, really just my outer presence and my outer body experience, and also making sure that I'm keeping up with my set. So the anxiety isn't the people. It's just it's more of a self thing.
Are you a perfectionist?
I may be with myself. I may be too hard on myself. I'm starting to realize that over the years. I'm way too hard on myself. And so I'm trying to give myself, I'm in a space of giving myself some grace. And also protecting my peace. It's never me being nervous or anxious because of the people or the amount of eyes on me. It's always self-inflicted.
I hope I get this set right and don't fuck up, type shit.
Just making sure you're not fucking up some words. Or even if you do stumble, I used to stumble and I could never catch and pick back up. But now, I can pick back up on some shit.
That's crossover, AI now for you.
You know what I'm saying? It's a lot easier now. It's a lot easier to go with the flow and not really give a fuck. And it's I feel like the more shows I do where I don't give a fuck is where I have my best shows. But the more shows where I'm trying to, be on point is the shows where I'm just fucking up. Even though I know I got it. I got this shit. I know I got everything memorized, but it's that one thing, something will happen and then it's just fuck. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. That fucked my whole experience up. And I'm trying not to be like that on myself.
Yeah.
Because I can get in a big habit of doing that shit all the time.
Yeah, I think it's something that we all do in different levels, in different fields, Is that self not self-sabotage, but just self-infliction of mental.
Self-infliction, self-sabotage.
It can lead to self-sabotage, yeah.
Yeah, mm-hmm. For sure.
Yeah, it definitely can lead to that. You're in what I feel like the, and not being biased, because I've had my fair share of people watch this podcast. Like, people know I love Cole, but at the same time, I haven't held my tongue back on certain things when it comes to like his early years when it came to production. But you're on the team where I feel like is the most lyrical team in the game right now, especially when you have the departure of somebody like a Kendrick leaving TDE, and then, you know, Griselda is going through their struggles like how you do. Mm-hmm. But shout out to them, they're doing their things. But when it comes to being around lyrical assassins like you're around, where iron is sharpening an iron, and then you have the head of it being a Cole, what are things that, when it comes to even just as simple as just like your set, that you've soaked in from being around people like that?
Just honestly, just making sure that whatever it is that you're doing is authentically you, and that you feel comfortable doing that, or that you feel comfortable, you know, like for me, the way I look at it, like even now with myself, like I'm trying to, like after being around so many people and being around certain people, like the main thing I'm trying to work on right now is like stage presence. So I'm like, bet, now I need to work at this. And it's like, I don't know, you just start to see things over the years, or you just start to see things and you just want to, like, you know, you just want to get better at those things and tap in, because you see what you can really tap into when you see like your potential and where you can really go with shit. And yeah. So for me, it's like, if I want to be a bigger artist, then I got to tap into my showmanship. I got to, you know, my stage presence got to be on point. But that goes back to my anxiety. My anxiety sometimes, like, you know, kind of crossfades with me wanting to be better at certain things, because I just feel like my anxiety holds me back from a lot of shit.
Yeah.
That I could be better at, or that I could be excelling in as an artist.
Yeah.
You know, but I hate that I talk about my anxiety as if it's like a person. You know what I'm saying?
It can be.
Yeah, but I hate that though. Like, yeah. I hate that, the fact that I've given it that much power. So I don't know. I guess basically, like, I'm in this space of like taking back that power that I've given anxiety, or whatever the fuck we putting names on things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was the same for me. I was just telling somebody, this person that I was. It's not even worth relevant talking about the person's name. But we were talking about anxieties. And I was telling her how, man, it was a time, bro, where I'd be freaking getting panic attacks, pumping gas. It was just like, I was like, the stress that I was putting myself through, and just like the mental anguish of just like, oh, man, who is this? And like, what is that? And like, just struggling from like PTSD, dealing like being one foot in, one foot out, and everybody dying around you. And it's just like,
for sure.
When you get to certain things like that, and then you're still here to see it, like the things that you, you know, dream for yourself, you almost have a survivor remorse in a sense, to where for me, my anxiety heightened even more, because it was just like, well, damn, am I about to die? Like, also, like, it was just like, dude, does that make sense? Or it was almost like,
it makes sense. I don't know, for me, like, my therapist asked me, like, what triggers my anxiety. I'm just like, bro, everything. Like, I don't even, like, it could be anything. Any little thing, any little detail that's off, like, that could trigger it. Like, just, I don't know. And I feel like it's more to it than just, like, anxiety or whatever. Like, I just feel like it's just so much shit. It's like, damn.
You
like,
smoke?
Mentally. I just recently started. Like, I don't smoke like that. So, I can't be out here like, yeah, you know, I'm a smoker and shit. Like,
yeah, I feel you.
But that shit don't help. That shit don't help me.
Spooked my ass. I had to quit.
Yeah, well, in the moments.
Yeah, I mean, I had someone put fentanyl in my shit. Like, this is back in the day. But I was smoking heavy. But even with that, like, everything is, I mean, it depends on the person, man. I'm an addicted personality, and so too much of anything could kill you. And I had moments where, you know, them wash your face moments, like, oh shit. And like, before I had the overdose, that was making me feel like, all right, like, this isn't really helping. Like, if anything, it's intensifying me. Like, I need to get to the root of this. This is just band-aiding it. And it got to a point where every situation, when it came with me, when it came to whether drugs, people, God forcefully put them out of my life. Yeah. Or God forcefully put that thing out of my life, whether it be going to the hospital or, you know, about dying. Like, because he knew with me, I had, that's the only way I could stop.
The thing is about, like, God and the universe, like, when the universe and God want you to remove something and you're not trying to remove it, they're gonna remove it.
Yeah.
It ain't gonna be the most pleasant way to get shit removed, but they're gonna find a way to remove it and also show you why it was removed and teach you a lesson.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So it's like, if you don't do it, the universe or God be like, all right, bet.
Yep.
Hold my beard.
Let me roll my shit. Yeah.
Hold my beard.
Exactly. That's what he's done with me plenty of times.
It's like, same. Hold my beard. But that's life. Life be life. And so fuck it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I have no regrets about it. You know, because if he wouldn't have done that, then I'd probably be dead somewhere in a ditch or something, man. Those things, like you said.
Mm-hmm. But that's why it's got to teach you a lesson.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like, you being ignorant to it, or you seeing a sign and knowing you need to stop doing or whatever it is that you're doing, and the universe just be like, all right, bro.
Mm.
All right, bet.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. It could get to a point where, like, he just let me go. Mm. You know, that's fortunate to where the universe and God was still just like, snap back into it. Because I feel like, you know, you get to a level where you ignore it too much, and then, you know, the universe is just going to take you.
Yeah.
You know, God just take you.
And it's got to take you through some shit. It's got to show you. So you know next time.
Yeah. Facts. You mentioned therapy. One thing that I was just talking to KB about, actually dealing with it. I talked to you a little bit about it that night where I was just like, you were talking about it. I was like, man, I think I'm going to go next week dealing with it, because I feel like that's something it's needed. It's needed where you can leave it somewhere and keep it there from a non-biased eye. When did you get into that mind frame where this may be a better option, you know?
It was the last option I had, honestly. Mm. It wasn't the fact that I thought it was a better option, because, to be real with you, the first time I even tried therapy, I almost didn't go. Mm. If the lady wouldn't have gave me the courtesy call, you know, to make sure that I was still pulling up, I would have, because I had already turned around.
Mm.
When she gave me the courtesy call, I'm like, damn, well, she already expected me, so I ain't even gonna flake like that.
Yeah.
So I ain't gonna say at the time it was the better option. It was just the last thing that I didn't try.
Mm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, and I done tried everything, even the bad shit. So it's like, this is my last option. After this, then I don't know. You know what I mean? But it ended up being the best thing I ever did.
Word.
In my eyes. Like, I feel like it's the best thing I ever did for me. And for, like, what I needed to tap into myself.
Mm.
Or a better me, if that makes any kind of sense.
Yeah. Yeah. For sure. It makes perfect sense. I think, because at the end of the day, this is just, for me, like that chart where it's like the evolution of man, where it starts off, homies like hunched over, and you just, you continually, it's like an onion
peeling. And to be real with you, that's my only concern.
The evolution, correct.
Is the evolution of just myself.
Yeah, that's the biggest thing.
Like, my main focus is my growth.
Mm.
Like, I don't care about nothing else around me, nothing else nobody else doing.
Yeah.
All I care about is am I being better than the nigga I was yesterday? Like, real shit. Like, am I learning from shit? Am I recorrecting patterns? Am I figuring myself out? Am I learning from the mistakes that I made or whatever? Like, I'm just trying to figure this life shit out so I can just be better at all times, my boy.
Yeah. Yeah. I feel like that's what we all are trying to figure out if we allow it. You kind of reminded me of, you had a song. It was just like, I feel like it was on 96. Might have been on part two, where it was like Crabs in a Barrel, where it's talking in a sense to where you're making me think about it, where not even just when it comes to being someone in the city, that can have that easily mind frame of being a crab in a barrel mentality. But even with your own health, with your own, sometimes you'll be that crab in a barrel having mentality like, oh, I don't need help. Or, you know.
No, you could definitely be the one that's keeping yourself from thriving.
Mm-hmm.
I know for a fact I'd be keeping myself from thriving just with certain things. And I'm just like, I'm trying to get out of that pattern. You know what I'm saying? So for me, it's like, yeah, you could definitely, your mind can definitely have that crabs in a barrel mentality on yourself. That's why it's like, man, I'm not really cared about the person beside me, behind me, in front of me, or whatever. Like, I'm focused on myself. Like, you got to keep it and stay at your own pace.
Yeah. When did you get to that point? Did you get to it recently through therapy, or was this just like an evolution?
I've always been the type of person that just beat to my own drum, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I always felt like I never really wanted to be in competition with anybody, because I just know that I'm only as great as my mind can take me. So it's like some days I know I'm off, or some days, you know, I don't want to do certain things to keep up with the Joneses. You know what I mean? Like, I'm not trying to keep up. Cause I know I have my days where I'm just I'm exhausted, I'm overwhelmed, I'm trying to figure myself out. What's the next move? Or even if it might be like, yo, I'm into this thing. It's like, you know what? Fuck it, I ain't into that no more. I want to try something else. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? I want to be able to do that without somebody saying, oh well, you know, he ain't on top of this no more. He ain't on top of that no more. It's like, well, I never really tried to be on top of anything. I was just
just doing me,
doing my thing. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? I was just doing me. I was just, you know, going with the flow of what I like then, and my desires you know, the shit that I'm into.
I'm not an introvert, I really just don't fuck with niggas. So to myself, nowadays it's really hard to read intentions. Funny how people who act distant say you acting different. Trust me, if I don't fuck with you, I keep it consistent. Life's a challenge, so for balance, had to right some wrongs. If it don't bring me peace, then please don't call my phone. Watch your tone, niggas want so much, I wish I had a clone. Feeling like Tyrese, what more you want from me?
At the end of the day, just be yourself.
Yeah.
It's a lot more easier to maintain.
Facts.
And it's a lot more comfortable.
Yeah. Heart's more free doing that, man.
Yeah.
You kids, be yourself out here. Don't be like the next man. I tell my nephew that.
There's no need to be.
Yeah.
There's no need to be.
Mm-hmm. I shout him out a lot because he's at that stage where he's 18. He's going through a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And he's trying to find himself, man. He's trying to find himself in a space lyrically, as a man. And it's just like, sometimes he'll 18, get tied in.
18, 17, that was definitely like a pivotal. That was definitely a pivotal point for me.
Yeah. It's a pivotal moment for him right now. He got a lot going on in his mental.
Yeah.
To where he's easily, he can go to the
left. So you definitely got to be there for him a whole lot more to, like, kind of guide and navigate the shit that he's going through or the shit that he's feeling. Because I wish I had that at that time, like, to just have somebody kind of, like, sit me down and really, like, tell me what it is. Now, my aunt did that for, my aunt was the one to really do that for me, though, was to, like, just sit me down and, like, kind of guide me about what, like, being an adult really looks like, or what that is.
Mm-hmm.
But I wish I really had that, like, I don't know.
I didn't really have that until later on, like in my 20s, when I was already an adult.
Yeah, so you got to be there, and you got to do that for bro, for sure.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's what I try to do, man. That's what I try to do, because he's in a unique space where, like I tell him, sometimes I feel like he feels like he can't be himself lyrically and get to the level that he wants to. But you're a living testament of that, you know? Like, he listens to y'all. He fucks with Phil's from,
that's fine.
He does a lot of stuff with Phil's when it comes to Phil's doing beats for him and stuff. So he knows all of y'all. Like, he listens to you, listens to Autumn. You know, he listens because he's in that zone where it's like he's fusing stuff when it comes to, like, melodic and like, hip-hop. And so I'll put him on game with Charlotte people. Mm-hmm. You know, I'll be like, listen to her, listen to him, listen to this, listen to that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he's trying to find his space. But then sometimes you'll look to the left and look to the right, and it'll get you out of tunnel vision, and you'll try to follow that trend, especially being 18.
Nah, for sure.
And so,
because you still trying to figure that shit out. You still trying to figure yourself out and figure your life out. Hell, at that time, I thought I was going to have my shit figured out by 25.
Boy.
Here I am, 33. 25. About to be 33. My Jesus year.
25. Still, I got divorced at 25.
You know what I'm saying? 25. Like, yeah. I was still... Hell, I had my daughter at 25.
It's crazy.
That was my introduction to 25. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Them papers was my introduction to 25.
Damn.
Like, damn. Wake up, motherfucker. Welcome to the real world. That's sign crazy. These papers. That's but crazy. It woke me up. You know, it put me to a level to where it was like, I got married early on to where, you know, I don't have any regrets with that situation because it...
Wait, you married?
I got married at the time.
Oh, you got,
I got
married.
Divorced. Oh, yeah, okay. I got divorced at 25.
I was like, what? Damn.
Yeah.
I didn't know you was married.
Mm-hmm. Grand opening, grand closing, man.
That's crazy, bro.
Yeah.
Damn. Mm-hmm.
At that time, though, I was too selfish, man. I was too selfish. Had a lot going on, trying to identify myself, mm-hmm. and at the same time, trying to be a husband. And so I don't give her none of the blame because, like, even with that situation, that was a situation where I got cheated on. But then getting back into, like, finding myself, I was like, what got her to the point of feeling? Because usually a woman will mentally check the fuck out of there before she actually physically does some shit.
Mm, for sure.
They'll get the fuck out of there mentally. And so I was like, what point was I at where she got the fuck out of here mentally? And I was never there. I was Rick James and shit. I was on the bag. I was drinking wine. Like, I was, you know, shit happened. And so, yeah, but I'm transparent. Like, people that watch this.
Feet in people's couch.
Yeah, putting my feet on niggas' couches. They're going to suplex and do walls. Like, for sure,
hey,
bro.
Yo.
Like, I was in that lifestyle. And so, you look, I'm old enough now to, like, be like, yeah, I dropped the ball on that. Mm. Like, cause it was a lot of you can't love someone if you don't know what love is, and I didn't know what love is at that time because I had a lot of hate in my heart. Even being married,
but like even in that, like, did you at that time did you think you knew what love was?
I knew that
cause you got married.
Yeah, I was in lust with her, and I was infatuated with it. I was infatuated with the idea of it, but real love, like, I think that's something that
did you cry at the wedding?
We didn't have a wedding. We had a party, and we got married at a courthouse. We got married at a courthouse, and then we just had a big-ass party, like a reception and stuff. Yeah.
I feel it.
But I cried later on. I cried. That was one of the moments. I cried because I was happy to get that over with when it came to marriage. And then
You talking about then, like after the marriage? Like, after the marriage over, or, like, after
both.
Y'all got married?
Both.
Oh, both. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Both. At the time, I was crying in happiness and crying in sadness.
Mm-hmm.
But that moment, I wish, like how you said, going back to my nephew, because my brother, my father, the men in my life, we got stronger the past half a decade.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't have that at that time. Like, even with my brother going through what he go through, it's a lot of stuff that I'm learning about him now that I didn't even know he went through at my age that probably would have helped me when I was going through that marriage, right. Someone who had been divorced. Same thing with my father. Like, me and my father didn't really get closer until he was fighting death, mm-hmm. like, a couple years ago. And so it was just, like, dealing with that. I feel you when it's like, I think that's why I try to be so much in my nephew's life now.
Mm-hmm.
'Cause it's just, like, I didn't have that. Like my brother said, my biggest memory of our uncle was like him getting a pizza one time. Mm-hmm. It was just like, that male figure was absent,
right.
Until we got older. And I feel like that's very imperative to have both sides, have that female perspective and that male perspective.
It's just important. Before I was thinking about doing, like, before I was even just like doing rap shit, like, had I graduated high school and went to school, I wanted to be a high school guidance counselor because I felt like, you know, it's a pivotal point in anybody's life, and I kind of want to be that for somebody.
Yeah.
You know, later on, like, I want to be able to navigate and guide them and let them know. Cause I lived in ISS. Like, ISS was like an elective to me, type shit. Like, that was part of my fucking schedule. That's how often I was
clocking
that
in.
Shit. So for me, it's like, yo, I want to talk to them kids.
Mm-hmm.
Cause them the kids I can connect with a whole lot more.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying. I just wanted to, but then now I look at the rap shit and I'm just like, you know, is it not that in a different way?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So, mm-hmm. I don't know. I just feel like I can really be there for kids that like that in that age group. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Going through shit and dealing with stuff. Because 9 times out of 10, it ain't really about, like, the school shit. It's about the outside shit that's going on in everybody's life.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah, so.
Yeah, that's facts. What's going on in the household and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. I think I got to that point as well where it's like, I think that's why I went back to school this year to get this certificate for mental health, because it was like, I felt like talking to people like him, and I started off just talking to people at, it should be a spot here called Brothers. Mm-hmm. It was over there off East Boulevard, where like it specialized with youth dealing with, like, they would come there after school. They would stay there for a while because it'd be with people that had drug abuse parents. Mm-hmm. And in that situation, like, it's a lot of anger in that. Mm-hmm. You know, it's dealing in a sense of, like, they're rooted in anger because it's a lot of pain because they're mad they don't have a home to go to. Mm-hmm. And so me being someone who I was, I feel like I'm right at that age to where I'm old enough to where they listen, but then I'm young enough at the same time where they'll listen.
If right. That makes sense. Nah,
they ain't coming from like an old head. And then even with what you're saying, it reminded me of when I was talking to my nephew when it came to like Charlotte stuff. Mm-hmm. When it came to Charlotte hip hop, because like you're to a level now, you're all over the place. But when we talk about, you know, like Rushmore, I ask people all the time, like, who's your Charlotte Rushmore? Your name comes up all the time. It's mm-hmm. like automatic, Lute. But then in particular with my nephew, he was like, this dude seemed mad chill. Like, I could have a beer with this guy. It was like, nigga, you don't even drink. Shit. Nigga,
hey, you say what, 17?
He's 17. Oh, yeah, okay, he 18
yeah.
now.
Oh, okay. Well, shit. Yeah,
this time. But that's the energy that you were giving him. Like, yeah. You know, it was something that he had never seen before when it came to Charlotte hip hop. Mm. When it came to like people in that level of like, you know, national attention. Mm-hmm. And for having somebody like that he could relate to, I feel like you're doing your job in that sense of like giving people that hope, giving that youth, like you said, you're doing it in another way. Because when it comes to someone who put in the footwork, did your thing, still doing your thing, still to the level where you're transparent in the sense of like letting people know, like, yeah, I'm a human man, I go through my stuff at the same time, and at the same time I'm not a dude to the point where I'm not gonna shake your hand in situations like that. People love to see that. I think everything that I've heard when it comes to you, it's not even necessarily dealing with the music. Because the niggas know that's there. It's the bars. But every time, like, when we talk about Rushmore, cats be like, man, he a real dude, man. He a genuine dude, man. That's a nice dude, man. Like, with Shane, like, I know you know Shane.
Yeah, that's my boy. Nah, I just try to show up when I can. You know, if I can. Like, and I just, again, like, it's all love for me. Like, I want to see niggas thrive. I don't want to see niggas holding each other back. I don't even want to see niggas holding themselves back. But it's always love for me. I just like seeing, again, I don't know why I keep repeating that shit, but it's the truth. Like, I just like seeing people thrive, bro.
Yeah.
Like, yeah.
That's what it's all about, man.
And like I said, like, I'll be outside like everybody else. I'm just so in my eyes, I feel like I'm just a normal dude. Like, I'll be where everybody else be at. Mm. I'll be where I still be at when it was Fair FC or before Fair FC. Like, we just, you know, I don't know.
Do you still talk to those guys?
Yeah.
You still fuck with like fucking,
yeah, like them my brothers.
That's what's up.
Yeah, for sure.
That's what's up. I think Kelso's out there in like Cali now or something like that. Or unless he was just visiting.
But he's probably visiting or something. But yeah, everybody's doing pretty good.
That's what's up, man. That's a beautiful thing to keep that intact as well. Mm-hmm. Because bonds like that, especially when you guys go through situations where you go through trenches, when it comes to just events and wanting, you know, like you said, the crab in the what you said in a song previously with the crabs in a barrel, that's imperative when it comes to, like I said, Charlotte hip hop as well. You know, we as a city get that a lot. Mm-hmm. When I talk to different artists on this platform, they talk about the crabs in a barrel mentality when it comes to the growth of Charlotte, where it's came a long way, but it's still a lot more that can be done. How do you see that in the level that you are now? What is the beauty of Charlotte hip hop that you have enjoyed to see the growth of, and what's something that still needs to be improved in?
Honestly, I feel like the beauty in it, and I've always said this, is to see how how Charlotte artists are able to convey the same message in a different genre or in a different way. I know a lot of people, they always think that, like, we have to have this sound. Like, Charlotte got to have a sound. Charlotte doesn't have a sound. It's like, bro, we don't need no sound. Like, we can give you all this shit. You know what I'm saying? We can give you all these different types of things. Like, I think that's the beauty in this city when it comes to, like, not even just, like, rap shit, but just music in general. Like, there's some talented fucking people here.
Yeah.
So, it's a lot, for me, it's like seeing that, because growing up, it was hard trying to, like, it was hard trying to do this shit. Even though we had our, we had our OGs and shit, and, and shit was bubbling. But now to see, like to see the shit that we've been through and where we've, like, sort of taken things individually with ourselves.
Yeah.
And then to see, like, a Mavi or, like, a Ruben Vincent or, like,
Young Beast.
You know what I'm saying? Like, to see, like, the younger cats, and they, like, thriving with this shit.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, where them niggas was at their age, I was nowhere near. You know what I mean? Yeah. So, for me, I love seeing that shit. Like, I love seeing that the shit is still, you know what I'm saying? It don't just, it didn't just stop with the OGs. It don't just stop with, you know, the collectives that we were all a part of. It don't just stop with that shit. Like, it keeps going. Yeah. And the thing is, like, at those times, like, we didn't know what the fuck we was doing. We didn't know where we was taking things. We didn't know. But to see that in that time when we was doing whatever we was doing, there were niggas watching us doing that shit. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And now they're taking molding. Notes. Now they're molding into, like, these fucking, like, just amazing fucking talented artists. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, so that shit for me is the shit that I love seeing. Like, just seeing that, like, it's a snowball effect. Like, the shit just keep going.
Yeah, for sure.
It just keep going. But being a part of that, you know, just having some sort of hand in that, like, it feels like, not that the job is done, but, like, you was doing the things that you needed to do, even unbeknownst to you. Like, but you was doing what you needed to do.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Like, it was helping somebody else, or it was inspiring somebody else. And even though we was oblivious to the shit at first, but now looking back at it, it's like, fuck. Like, that shit is amazing.
Yeah. It's a beautiful thing.
Yeah.
It's kind of like what the quote that Pac did back in the day. I think he was like, I may not be the one to change the world, but I may spark the mind.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And I think it comes, when you think of how the evolution of Charlotte hip hop has been, you see that in sense of, you know, it kind of reminds me of what you're saying when I had Ferrara on here, and he was like, you know, man, growing up, he was like, shout out to the OGs, but I didn't really have that, because it really wasn't no plan. It wasn't no blueprint of how to get on.
It wasn't, though. Like, it's never been. Like, how you get on ain't going to be the same way I get on.
Yeah.
And how he gets on ain't going to be the same way the next person gets on. Yeah. Like, that's the thing about Charlotte. There is no blueprint. Like, you know what I mean? You just get in there and get your hands dirty. You know what I'm saying? Like, but even in that, like, again, when we was doing this shit, when we was grinding this shit out, like, we had no idea. We didn't really necessarily have a plan.
Yeah.
Like, we knew where we wanted to be with it, but there wasn't a, like, so we're going to do this, do that, or, like, because niggas ask all the time, like, yo, what's some advice? And I'm just like, man, I'm still figuring this shit out with my damn self. I'm still trying to comprehend, or, like, I'm still in shock of how this happened for me. You know what I'm saying? So, you can be inspired, and you can look around or whatever, but, like, there is no blueprint to this shit.
Mm-mm.
You know what I'm saying? So however you feeling, and that's why when people even ask me about certain things, like, somebody will send me some music and be like, yo, bro, how you feel about this? And I always be like, first, how do you feel about it?
Because
I can tell
that's
you.
That's the real question.
I can tell you whatever or however or whatever, but, nigga, if you think that this is the craziest shit that you ever done or the craziest shit you ever did, what I'm about to tell you ain't really going to matter.
Nah.
You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Oh, it shouldn't matter. Yeah.
But it's just, I don't know. I just feel like you just, it not being no blueprint, you just really just got to trust yourself and trust your process and whatever team that you got behind you.
Yeah.
You just got to trust that shit.
Yeah, I agree.
You know?
That's very key. I would say to, like, because the only thing that I would say is the nucleus when it comes to, you know, getting on that I tell younger people, and even with myself, my Achilles heel, I tell people all the time, my Achilles heel was consistency. Mm. And one thing I would say that's the same thing with the people like yourself, the Ferrars, the Wellses, the people that's doing their thing, is that they stay consistent. You know?
I'm going to be real. I don't even know.
You had your moments of consistency.
I don't even know if I would necessarily stay consistent.
You stay consistent enough, nigga.
This is me being honest. I don't think I necessarily stay consistent. It's just for me, when it was time for me to do something, I wanted to make sure at all times that my shit was in order. Mm. So when I did drop some shit, it was well put together. Mm. It wasn't just throwing you some shit to be throwing you some shit to show you that I'm doing shit.
So you're
like, you know, I'm doing shit when I drop some shit, but I didn't hold on to it long enough to where, and this is no shade because I know a lot of artists do this, but like, you got like, somebody told me not the other day, it was like maybe like a couple of weeks ago, like, yeah, bro, I got like over 900 songs on my computer. Mm. And I'm like, nigga, why? Like, why? That's so much space on your computer. And not the fact that like, something was wrong with the songs, but it's like, my nigga, what are you holding them on to for?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Why are you holding on to them? If you got like 900 songs, my nigga, you know how many albums and mixtapes that is? Or like, stupid. The fact that you can just be like, all right, cool. Like, so I'm going to take these strong songs. I'm going to make a video to these three songs. Mm-hmm. You already got the songs recorded. Like, so you can kind of take your time now with the push and the rollout with the song. So I think it's crazy to be sitting on songs for like years. Like, put that shit out. Mm-hmm. Put it out. Come up with a plan. Put it out. Drop it. You got that many songs, you can be consistent for a whole year and not do shit.
Yeah.
900 mm-hmm. songs? Nigga, if I had 900 songs, bruh, I would never spit on the. I would never rap again, bro.
900. That's some Gucci Mane shit.
I have an album. I have a rollout for all those songs for so long, nigga. Mm.
I mean,
that's cool though. You know what I'm saying? That's fire. It shows like, yeah. Yo, you really be
in the studio. Yeah,
in the studio, and you really dedicated. And not even just the person or somebody who has not. It's just like, yo, if you holding on to the music, like, that's fire, but at some point you gotta let go of that music.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, you doing all this shit and you doing it in the mindset of the world hearing it, but you holding on to it for 3 years, like, let it go.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It's time to let it go. I had a problem with that in the beginning. Mm. But looking back now, it's like, bro, why the fuck was I sitting on songs like that? Mm. You know what I mean? And when I could have just been, and now that I have more understanding about how rollouts go and how, you know, just how things work. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't know.
I think some artists are waiting for like a particular type of moment when they're.
You gotta create the moment.
I was just about to say that. You gotta put that stuff out there.
You can't wait on no moment. You gotta create a moment. And then maybe sometimes the moment that you're waiting on don't even align with the song that you're trying to drop.
Yeah.
So you gotta create the moment. Like, if you got tons of music, come up with a plan to dropping that music. Don't sit on that shit for too long.
Yeah. Because then you'll get to a level to where sooner or later, years ago, by, you'd be like.
Because then that shit just become a hobby. You just collecting songs now.
Yeah.
Mm. Like, you telling people like, yeah, bro, I'm next up. I got all this. And it's like, well, where is it?
You like Boy Who Called Wolf.
Yeah. Like, where the music at?
Yeah.
Or you got all, you know, I'm just saying, like, just drop those shits, bro. Like, you got to.
Yeah, you got to, man. Gotta get that shit out for the universe to hear. Somebody is waiting on that. When it comes to how you drop stuff, your method of dropping stuff, you just I ain't even gonna get into the rollout exactly, but you've had enough time for this most recent project to marinate. Like, the world has had enough time for it to settle in. How did you like the reception of it?
I loved it. It was probably the most positive reception I've ever got out of anything that I dropped. I'm just glad people was able to receive it. Not necessarily the way that it was meant to be received, but I'm just glad people was able to receive it and got a message out of it, and it was able to do something for them, as, you know, it was doing for me in that time and space.
It's very therapeutic.
And it's crazy that I didn't know what to expect from this album. I was actually super nervous and super anxious about releasing it because I thought it was too vulnerable. I thought it was too transparent.
Yeah. So I enjoyed it though. I think it's your best body of work.
But when I hear that, people say, I appreciate that though. Mm. I appreciate that for real, for real. Because a lot of people, a lot of people say like that the album was super therapeutic to them.
Yeah, it was.
And for me, it's like, damn, that's crazy because I didn't know how niggas was gonna receive this shit.
Mm. Yeah, that's usually how it goes though. When you're in that zone of, because for you, it's just you giving us your world, opening us into the world to where you, at that moment you're not even thinking of it like that. Where,
right?
How many people is this chick gonna touch? Like, you're just trying to get this shit out, really.
Yeah, just trying to get this shit out, get it off my chest. And for me, it's just like, am I being too transparent? Am I being too open? Like, that shit was giving me anxiety just writing it. And but like I said, I'm just glad that everybody received it well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Word.
It took me a while. I went through a lot of shit with that album, just internally and like just life shit. Like, I went through a lot. So I love the album. I love the way it sounds. I love the way it came out. I love the texture of it. You know what I mean? Like, I just fuck with the album.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like a I feel like it will age well as well. Mm-hmm. Like a wine. I feel like it'll age good as well.
Yeah, and like even with people who don't receive it. Like, people might say like, yo, this shit trash, and I'm like, yo, that's cool. Like, either you really don't fuck with it, or you just might not have experienced something, or you might not have experienced what I was going through in the album. And that's,
or maybe
okay.
Maybe they are, and you're bringing them too close to home to where they like, that, I don't want to hear this shit.
But either way, it's just like, yo, like, it just wasn't for you though. Like, and that's okay. Like, I'm cool with that. Like, I've been in a space where it's like, yo, everybody's not gonna like your music. Everybody's not gonna fuck with it. Everybody's not gonna relate to that shit. Like. Yeah. So for me, it's just like, yo, that's perfectly fine. Who it don't connect with, like, I'm cool with that.
Yeah, it'll touch who it need to touch.
Right.
Yeah, I went through that even with just the early years of this. Like, sometimes, especially when I had a situation where I had a co-host, because I think I told KB this. Like, when that situation went under, I felt relieved in a sense because I told Kay, I was like, I felt like I was getting to a level where I was doing shit I didn't want to do.
Mm.
And it wasn't the meaning of what As of Late was about. As of Late was really a outlet to be like a time capsule in a sense, because I felt like nobody was really giving these stories about these beautiful artists in the city. And really asking them how they're feeling, because I feel like being an artist, being a creative, whether it's a, you know, whether it's a painter, whether it's a musician, whether it's a chef, it's all an art. And I feel like we're some of the most vulnerable human beings that deal with a lot of struggles. And so really, when I was going through my struggles, I made this to ask people, like, how are you getting through your struggles? And like, how are you? And I found myself getting to a level where it was getting too much about the oh, we got to get these many views, and oh, like, now we need to be worrying about sponsorships. And where it was just like, of course, like, I would love to have that, but then I was like, man, like, this ain't me at all, man. Like, we doing shit, we having interviews with niggas I don't give a damn about. Like, it's just like, I made this shit and the shit ain't even mine no more. it got to a point where it's just like, man, I'm really losing myself into that. So when that situation went under, just like I was saying about God earlier on, where it's like, he forced that situation out. Yeah. And I was worried about it at first because I was like, man, like, this nigga did everything. Like, he was like my 40 in a sense of when it came to the editing.
Mm-hmm.
He really the 40, but like, I had to learn how to do all that shit. But at the same time, I have no regrets because it made me and KB closer.
Mm-hmm.
And it made me step it up to the point to where, like, I learned how to do the behind the scenes stuff to where now I love it. Mm-hmm. Like, I love dealing with stuff like that. And so, it was a blessing in disguise, man, at the end of the day.
No, I feel it, because I just remember the spaces that I was in when I was writing Goldmouth, but, like, to hear it finished and complete, I never forget, like, sitting there, like, damn, I had no idea that I was really writing the story out like this at the time I was creating it. Like, I was just venting and getting shit off my chest, but, like, hearing it all together, I was like, what the fuck? Like, I had no idea that I had this type of body of work sitting right here in front of me.
Yeah. That's how it was with this. When it came to it being needed, I feel like the city needed it. And I found myself, I said that, brought it back because it was a point to where it was like I was depending too much on what other people were thinking. And I lost the identity truthfully of what it was to where I had to be in the point of going back to how I was in the beginning, like when you made that album. You weren't making it in the sense of like, this is going to be on Billboard.
Right.
Or like, this is going to be the hot song. Like, you're just making shit to make shit for the beauty of it.
Yeah, like,
Whatever catches.
I don't care about the numbers. Like, I don't care about the views. I don't care about how many followers a feature got. Like, I don't care about none of that. Like, I just want to create music.
I don't switch lanes. I don't switch up. Big whip, big commas. Big drip, no drama. No harm, no karma. That's why a nigga just get in and go. I just pick up where I started. Some nights leave me heartless. It is what it is, cause I never fold. The music is charted. I guess I'm an artist. I gotta make sure that my story is told.
I wanna ask you this before we close out, if you'll say it, cause you know you have a lot of friends in the industry, so you may not wanna hurt anybody's feelings. But that's another dude when it comes to when I think of Charlotte, that is like took people to the level of knowing what Charlotte is as a city. Like, when you think of Steph Curry, like the dude that, like, I remember seeing him, like, we used to go to the same, like, AAU and, like, basketball camp, and that motherfucker went to Davidson. And so seeing somebody like that, it reminds me of you in the sense of how I feel like you can look at that from somebody that was in the city and then made it the way that they made it, just, you know, working their ass off.
I appreciate
playing,
that.
Playing the game that he played, you know.
Like, I don't think I made it yet. Like, I'm still.
To me, I mean, it defines, for me, what is making it to you, you know?
That's a good question. But in that, like, what everybody else's made it looks like to me is completely different.
That's true.
You know what I mean? Like, people look at it like, oh, nigga, you made it. And I'm looking like, nigga, I'm just getting started. Like, I'm just now getting to the space that I saw myself. Or I'm just now getting in those spaces where,
and that's an even more beautiful thing, man.
You know, but like, I don't think I made it. Like, I still move like a local artist. You know, like, and I feel like, you know, in certain ways, you know, I know some people get on me about that, but like, I don't know, bro. I just still feel like I'm grinding it out. I'm thugging it out. I'm building the plane and flying it at the same time. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
So, I don't know. I think it's dope people think I made it. Or I think it's dope that people think that I'm like, you know, whatever. But
yeah,
to me, it's like, nigga, I'm still.
Yeah, and you, and of course you're gonna, you would feel that way because it's you. But then, like, I, you know, from someone, like I said, someone born and raised here, in the sense of, like I said, it defines on what you think of making it. For me, making it based off, like I said, I've met Steph before. It was the blow up. And I've seen the work that you put in. We're formally getting to know each other now. I can't say that I knew you back then. Like, I knew Steph. But at the same time, the work ethic, somebody that's from the city, and in that sense, like, can come back and still get love. Because some people, you know, they don't get love in their own city. You know, I feel like when it comes to being respected in a sense of like, yo, that dude, nobody can be like, yo, I ain't never seen this nigga before. Like, you like, when was this nigga getting it in? Like, if you a Charlotte native, you know the history of, like, this nigga been doing his damn job of putting his work in and transition to the level where he's continuing to put work in and show off of the city. And it's the same when it comes to, like, people like Steph. That's what I mean by making it. Like, you can look back and be like, man, that nigga made the city proud, man. Even in a sense of, like of course, it's more to accomplish. Like, Steph definitely wants his ring. But if he was to stop now, I'd be like, man, that nigga put on for the city, man, in a sense like that. That's what I mean by the sense of making it. Like, you can be proud and look back and be like, damn, like, even in a sense with Kurt, like, you know, like, Kurt goes through his flaws and a lot of people give him, like, shit. But he brought a level to where people can look at Charlotte in another avenue. And so, like, that's still a level of making it in a sense. Like, he's we ain't have no superstar like that. That's crazy. You know, he's like, to me, he's like our generation's like Ludacris in a sense when it comes to like his videos and shit like that, how he does that. He brought that avenue back. And so it all comes down to
it's definitely
looking back and how you think making it is. in the eyes of me, I feel like you made it, man. It's just only more, like you said, it's, of course, it's more to accomplish, but at the same time, you made the city proud, man. I hear these niggas out here. You
I know? Appreciate that, bro.
It's a beautiful thing to see.
I appreciate that. I tried to showcase the streets we walk down, you know, like, I don't know. Mm. I just being out with my niggas or, you know, dealing with whatever.
Yeah.
Just trying to showcase what it's like.
Word.
You know?
Yeah. You done a good job. Got the lady behind you. You making me I might want to daggone get back on Plenty of Fish or something. Damn yeah, it, daggone.
You got to get you a Christian's Mingle account, bro.
Nah. I ain't tried that.
You got to get you a Christian's.
Been there, done that. I
don't want to see you on Catfish, bro. I don't want to see I've you on Catfish.
I've been catfish. Yeah. I've been catfished by Chicken Gastonia.
Yo, word. Yeah. Gastonia out of all places.
Yep, robbed my ass. Yep.
Robbed you? Yep. You was sending money? You were tricking?
No, I went to her house and she had a dude there waiting and robbed me at gunpoint.
Here comes dumbass Ashley Larry.
What a dice?
Yo, give me that money, son. Go upstairs and put on some lotion. Bank it.
Told me just to empty the trash. Yo, you live like probably the craziest life that I like, nigga. I know we just recently met, but I feel like it's so many stories behind you, bruh. Cause what you got? Yeah. Hey, we gotta have
many layers, man. Many layers.
We gotta have a beard so you can like. Tell niggas about these stories, bro.
We definitely can, man.
You need a podcast about these stories.
Yeah, I mean, for sure. You know,
do like an animated series.
I thought about doing that. Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
I definitely thought about doing that with voiceover work because that's something I'm trying to get into more, in particular with voiceover. But that's a topic for another day. I wanted to ask you before closing out your Rushmore when you think of like when it comes to Charlotte in general. Who would be on your Rushmore when it comes to people that you looked up to? And it could be people like present day. Like, who's I'll give you a five because I ask people that and they be like, oh, it's just four up there. So we'll carve a fifth one in there. We'll put Obama in there. Like,
What's your five?
When it comes to Charlotte, we got my five.
Oh, wait, when you put your five, like, what do you, like, what is the Rushmore? Is the Rushmore just like legends in the city? Is the Rushmore like what's currently popping? Like what is the Rushmore based off of?
We can do it either or. For me, it's we've done currently. I usually do it based off legends in the city who've left imprints on the city and continue to do it. And some of these are current artists. Like some of these are gone. I mean, not gone in the sense of like they've retired. And then some of these are still rapping to this day. Like you still rapping to this day. Jay Elevator, he's still doing his thing. Now,
Elevator Jay is definitely in the Mount Rushmore.
I mean, when it comes to like
everything,
like
that nigga is definitely in the Mount Rushmore.
Farrar's in my Rushmore.
Yeah, for sure. I feel like it's not enough Rushmores to my list is big. When I say my list is big, I don't mean like my list is big because I'm like not trying to defend nobody, but like I feel like my list is big because it's a lot of Mount Rushmores. Mm. You know what I mean? Like it's a lot of niggas out here. It's a lot of artists out here that have set a lot of different ways or a lot of different set a lot of different things in the culture that help push the culture forward. You know what I mean?
You're right.
And I honestly can't pick a top five.
Okay.
I can't pick a top five. I just know whatever Mount Rushmore niggas have, Elevated J is definitely in that
Rushmore. In any one of them.
In any one of those.
Yeah. I admit, yeah. Jay, what he's done, what he continues to do, he out the way too. Like, Jay, he don't be doing, like, I'm going to try to get him on here, but he's like a unicorn. He's out the way.
It's the best way to be, man. You just minding your business. You're in your own, your own lane.
Yeah, man. That's the best way to be, man. I mean, clearly you living.
I know niggas probably wanted me to give him out Mount Rushmore, but I'm not even gonna give him out.
He ain't hurt y'all feelings.
I just know
he ain't hurt y'all feelings. The people you weren't gonna say.
I just know ain't nobody gonna deny Elevator J being in a Rushmore. So
yeah,
I'm gonna stick with my.
What about OG Rushmore? Like OG Rushmore people, like who did you come up on where it was like for OGs to be like
shit, my big bro Betty Grind.
Easy Green
for sure. Royalty, yeah, Betty Grind. Mr. 704.
Yo, I ain't heard that yet. Shout out to Mr. 704.
Numo 3, but shit. Growing up, I knew bruh's S-Dub.
Yeah. Shout out to Dub.
You know, so it's a lot of my homeboy DJ DR.
Legend. First DJ I know went to France.
Yeah. Nah, that's my guy.
But
for me, these are like OGs, you know what I mean? Like these are.
That's like Preview. You remember Preview? The Preview days?
Yeah.
Like it's the first time I seen DR.
Yeah.
I'm just like, yeah, he's a staple, dude.
Yeah,
shout out to DR, man. Shout out to all the people that laid foundations that have built houses, because there's so many different houses when it comes to like the Charlotte community.
But that's what I'm saying. That's why the Rushmore, it get tricky, because it's so many different niggas have done so many different things and so many different avenues. It's just hard to.
Yeah. Well, you gave me one. I mean, you gave me one. I just had to break it down.
Yeah.
Even further. You gave me an OG one. That's good.
Yeah.
I ain't going to do a present one because we ain't going to hurt nobody's feelings. There's a lot of young gunners out here.
But it's a lot of niggas doing shit.
That's what I mean. It's a lot of niggas doing shit.
It's a lot of people, and it's a lot of artists doing shit amazingly, like doing shit really well. So it's like,
yeah.
I can't even put the cap at 5. Like, it's just niggas out here doing shit, and I'm just glad to see the shit.
Yeah. Like right now, present, I put like I said, like you, I put Fetty P. I'm a really big Fetty P fan.
That nigga's
voice is just like that nigga has a distinctive voice to where it's like
that's a real dude.
Yeah, I heard you got some work with him as well, like in the works.
Yeah, for sure.
Ferrara, let me know on that.
Yeah, for sure.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, I just left the studio with them yesterday.
That's what's up.
Yeah.
That had to be crazy. Like how are you when it comes to, and then I promise I'm gonna close it out with this. How is it with you when it comes to collabing? Like
I'm cool with collabing, but for me, like and people that I do collab with, they know like for me, it's not even about the collab. It's us just chopping it up and getting to know each other or just going to go grab a beer and just, you know,
organic.
Yeah, just some organic shit. Like just because I meet you as an artist don't mean I'm automatically trying to do a song with you. Like, nah, like I'm just here for, what's the word I'm looking for? I don't want to say the camaraderie and shit, but like, you know what I mean? Like, you just, we just here shooting the ones. Like, we just chopping it up and just kind of picking each other's brains and seeing where we at with shit and with life. And,
yeah,
you know, if you need me for anything other than music, like, you know, I'm here when I can. I'll be here when I can, like, type shit. Like, so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I don't mind collabing with other people. I don't do it often, but not because I don't want to. It's just that for me, collabing is just, I'm not a nigga that does shit for somebody wanting loot on a song or whatever. Like, if the song fit, it fit. If it don't, like, I'm not trying to push it. I'm not trying to rush it just because somebody want me on a song.
Yeah.
You know, I just wanted to make sense. Even when I reach out to people to be on songs, like, I just wanted to make sense. I wanted to just, you know, be a natural thing, and we just here for the song and not for whatever intentions you got trying to make the song to be because of XYZ.
Yeah, that makes any kind of sense. Like, you and Devin made sense.
Yeah, because like, that's my nigga, though. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, you notice, like, anytime, and it's like, and it's not that, like, I'm people who aren't my nigga I don't do features with, but it's just easier that way to connect on a song when you really know somebody. Like, it's just hard for me, like, if I don't know you, to really do a song.
Yeah. You bought that soul out of Devin, man. That man put that CeeLo, bro. That CeeLo.
That
I said, you got that daggone CeeLo soul out of here, boy.
Nah, that nigga Devin be singing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, for sure.
It was refreshing to hear him in that way, because he had just came out with a project where he was more in a melodic type of zone, which he dominates anything he do. Mm-hmm. That was my first time hearing him like that, though. Mm-hmm. And so I was like, yo, that's dope to hear him singing that kind of.
Nah, he be having shit. And I'm like, bro, you got to Like, just keep thriving on niggas, bro.
Yeah.
For real. Keep thriving. I say that shit to everybody. Like, nigga, I be seeing niggas, and I'm like, bro, keep going. Like, do your fucking thing.
Word. What's on the agenda, man? Seems like you got a, when is that, what is that, day in Vegas or something coming up in like September Vegas. Or
honestly,
something?
Honestly, bro, I'm just working.
Kicking it, being a pops.
Yeah, just working and staying out the way. Yeah, so.
Best festival you performed at?
Rolling Loud, New York. I think that was the, like, I ain't gonna say the best, but it was, like, recently, like, the most fun I had on stage in a minute. Like, I've had fun on stage, but, like, the most fun I had on stage in a minute.
Word.
Yeah.
That's what's up. Dope stuff. New York has good crowds.
Yeah, it was cool.
Yeah.
It was cool.
Dope stuff, man. Lute, man, I appreciate you coming, brother.
Nah, bro, I appreciate you having me.
Yeah, man, of course.
Now we about to go watch this game.
for sure, man.
But nah, I appreciate you.
Not a problem, man. Not a problem at all, man. Welcome anytime to hear some more of those stories that I have.
We'll do those off camera. You definitely got to tell me them stories, bro. Because, nigga, catfish by somebody in Gastonia?
Yeah, we'll get into that later.
Nigga, I got to hear the rest of that shit.
Yep, gunpoint. This is As a Wet.